Welcome everyone, back again. We have a nice new webinar series prepared from Europractice. I hope that you all enjoyed the summer holidays. So this is the fifth webinar series that we have organized. So to remember, we had the first one on the advanced photonics packaging, a second one on microfluidics, then we had one on silicon photonics foundries, then we had recently one on MEMS technology, and now we have a new one on flexible electronics. So I will be your host in these three webinars that are in the program. My name is Romano Hofman. I'm general manager at Europractice. And you can see here, and I'm very excited about it, a nice program of three webinars in this series of flexible electronics. So in the first one, Chris Meany will introduce us to the world of flexible electronics. Then in 2 weeks from now, Vincent Barlier from Pragmatic will focus on their technology of flexible integrated circuits. And then the last webinar will be one given by Quad Industries, more specifically by Wim Christiansen, and he will focus on flexible printed electronics, more or less the technology that they provide. So having that said, I would like first to introduce Chris, and then Chris can take the floor. So Chris Meany received his PhD degree in electrical engineering from the KU Leuven in 2013. And now he's a principal member of technical staff and R&D team leader at IMEC. He is also part-time professor at KU Leuven, and he specializes in circuit design for flexible thin film transistor applications. His work has been widely published in numerous international journals, including very leading ones like Nature Electronics and several ICC contributions. He was listed as one of the Belgian top tech pioneers by the business paper De Tijd, and received in 2018 the European Young Researcher Award for Design of Thin Film Electronics. In 2016, he also received the prestigious ERC starting grant from the European Commission to enable breakthrough research in thin film transistor circuits. And now he is also a member of the Young Academy of Belgium, where he serves as a track chair for the FLEPS conference. So having that said, I would like to give the floor to Chris, and I wish you all a nice webinar. To some practicalities, so for now the cameras and the videos are disabled, also the chat. At the end of the presentation, I will open up the floor for questions, so then you will be able to ask questions to Chris. Chris, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Romano, for your very kind introduction, and also thank you for organizing this, to also my opinion, beautiful webinar series on flexible electronics. As I said to you like 10 minutes ago, in fact, this is a nice moment because flexible electronics, we talk about this already for a very long time, but now you see there is a nice momentum where some things are really paying off and are getting started. So this, well, my talk today will be to introduce flexible electronics. And before I do that, I first would like to say, what is flexible electronics? What is printed electronics? Because there is quite some confusion nowadays. Always when I'm at a conference, they always ask, is your circuit printed or is it flex? So let me try to give you a high level perspective on this. Printed electronics we can recognize from roll-to-roll printing or screen printing, so really printing activities. And why is it used or why is it very nice? You can see here, for example, very large area structures like OLED lighting, like solar panels, but on the other hand, it doesn't need to be extremely large area. It can also be printed sensors and actuator components on flex, on foil. These devices are typical large area. In contrast with this one, you have also thin film manufacturing. And in these devices, there is always a transistor. This is what I call flexible transistor electronics, in fact. Here you can see a plate where they manufacture 6 TVs. And the way how they manufacture a flex TV, for example, would be to take the glass, you laminate a foil or you add a foil to it, you process your TV or your flexible mobile phone, and then you delaminate your foil from the glass substrate and you have a flexible phone. In fact, here you can see what you can make. You can, for example, generate or realize a very large TV, or you can also realize a very small circuit, but fully flexible, in fact. What is the main difference now? Well, these devices, these are typical micrometer size, so high resolution devices versus larger area devices. Let's take one more deep dive. And for example, I took here from the website of Quad Electronics at the left, one of their examples of printed flexible electronics. This comprises printed sensors, printed actuators. You can also consider printed circuitry or batteries. And last but not least, as you can see, there is also the hybrid integration with silicon chips on flexible medium. The contrast was a flexible microprocessor, for example, which is flexible TFT electronics. You generate high density transistor arrays, so multiple transistors, very small footprint, micrometer size, and this is really high performance electronics on a fully flexible, rollable circuit. Now, there is something in the middle, because there is also the printed RFIDs with printed transistor components. For example, Sunshine University, from Professor Cho, in fact, they are working on printed RFIDs. The main challenge for them is, in fact, to get to the small footprint, which is needed, as I will explain later, to get to specific targets, and to downsize, well, the area and the performance, in fact. Okay, so in the rest of the presentation, I will mainly focus on this technology, flexible TFT electronics. The third webinar of this series will be by Quad Industries, and I'm sure that they will enlighten you with the printed flexible electronics. So thin film, what are the advantages of thin film electronics on flex substrate? In fact, here you can see it's really ultra thin. Another one is it's also, because of that, very lightweight. So you can realize lightweight electronics. It's extremely flexible without performance degradation and it's low cost potential. Then I write here unbreakable. In fact, if you give it to my kids, it's not unbreakable, but for normal use, it's unbreakable. Why do I say that? You go to a shop, you buy a smartphone, you exit the shop, you drop it, your screen is broken. It's because it's not flex. If you would have a flex foil and you drop it, it would go like a leaf and it will not break. In fact, that's what we mean with unbreakable electronics. Now, I'm sure many of you are familiar with silicon chip technology, CMOS. So how does it compare both of these technologies? Well, silicon CMOS technologies, this is high performance. The chip thickness is about millimeter size and it's not really flexible. There is, on the other hand, thin film transistor technology has a thickness of only micrometer size. It's fully flexible. The disadvantage is that it has a low performance compared to silicon CMOS. Another good thing, or another advantage of thin film transistor technology would be the low cost per unit area. Let's now dive into a couple of applications. This is, for example, an active matrix OLED display that we have made. It's fully flexible. It was rollable. We have shown that on a conference. And in addition, you can actually buy already today flexible phones. If you now would remove the OLED layer, so the light layer, and you would make a light detection layer, you can in fact make a large area imager. Large area, it's nice because then you can make a palm print instead of only a fingerprint for advanced security, or even because of the wavelength of the organic photodetector is a bit wider, you could detect near infrared, so you could also detect heartbeat detection. Those are very nice examples of novel things what you can do with these technologies. As I showed you, this is something like how the TVs are made. So in the end, this is also nice for large area applications, such as large area X-ray. These are all made similar as the large area detector of the previous slides, but then there is also a scintillator converting the X-ray into visible photons. Another option is, of course, you can make it large area, but you can also decrease your area for, or it doesn't need to be, but you can also make a curved X-ray detector or a rollable X-ray detector. In fact, together with our colleagues from the Hall Center, we published recently in Nature Flexible Electronics this curved X-ray detector with an IGZO TFT backplane, which is a metal oxide backplane, with an organic front plane, organic photodetector front plane, and it could function very nicely in this X-ray tests. We have talked about fingerprint and optical ways of fingerprinting. This one is also another interesting option. And this option is by means of thermal sensing, because there is a difference in between the temperature transfer of the ridges and the valleys. And we have been making an algorithm and a detection algorithm, and we have been able to demonstrate this principle on this TFT platform. Another interesting and novel technology, in fact, would be MEMS. MEMS, as you can see in this, which is mostly a PMUT, a piezoelectric transducer, you can see in the stack you have a top metal, a bottom metal, you have the piezo layer, the green layer in between, and you have a membrane. By applying some voltages, you will be able to move the membrane, and you make, in fact, a very small drum, a micrometer drum. Now, the single elements are smaller than 500 micrometer, as you can see here, and now you can combine that in larger arrays and also very large area substrates. So you're not limited to the silicon area, you can really make large area. The nice thing is, because you have more area, you will also have more local constructive sound waves. What we now did was, here you see our large area, and you can see that by applying the right voltages to the right PMUTs, you can locally create pressure points in mid-air and start playing piano in air, in fact. So some examples, but now I have an issue with the videos. Okay, it works. So some examples could be, if you imagine you make this large array of PMUTs, you can generate locally in mid-air a high pressure point, which could be used for haptic feedback. Another one, and I will redo this video, would be to put PMUTs at specific positions, and you can do gesture recognition. Some typical applications for this ultrasound technology, which can be manufactured on top of a flat panel display TFTs, would be, as you can see, the gesture control, would be contactless touchscreens, but also, for example, virtual object manipulation, where a surgeon could feel or could get tactile feedback of the organ. Besides having the front plane, if you now only take the transistor layer, you can make transistor circuits. A good example here would be this microprocessor OnFlex, which was published at ISCC. Circuit, and that's more an IoT circuit, an Internet of Things circuit, would be an RFID or an NFC tag based on thin film electronics. And we have also shown that at several ISCCs so far. The IoT roadmap would be also very interesting for objects, for the low-end objects, such as paper, etc. Imagine you would like to put this card, this game card, imagine you want to connect it to the internet. What we proposed was to use NFC as an interface, because our electronics can work with NFC medium, and then we can connect directly to one of these devices which is connecting our game card or our wine bottle to the internet. A last option there could be the wearable wireless health patches. Some of these examples will come back later in the technical part of this presentation. I just give you one more possibility with this technology. In fact, flexible neuroprobes. Neuroprobes to do electrocortography, which is the ECOG, which is interesting for high density neural recording. So we have been making 500 micrometer pitch arrays, which are flexible in fact, as you can see on the apple. It can nicely be conform the surface, and it could be used for high density recording, but also high density stimulation. This slide shows actually our track record in this field. In fact, we are working now for more than 1.5 decades on this topic. And you can see that slowly our complexity of the systems have been increasing and published at the premier conferences like ISSCC or IDM. Also recently, we have published in Nature Electronics our thin film NFC tag or our touchscreen tag, which I will come back later to as well. Then, together with our colleagues from TU Eindhoven, we have worked on a wearable health patch. And as Romano kindly introduced, I've been working on an ERC starting grant with my team for the last 4.5 years, in fact. And the main topic was to build higher density, higher performance circuits with consuming lesser power. And we introduced some kind of a Moore's law on flex. So, if you now think about flexible electronics and low cost, because this always comes back, how can this happen? Well, in fact, the first, there's two options, and I will start with flat panel display industry. Here you can see a TV, and this is made on a glass plate of, for example, 3 meter by 3 meter. You can see that there are 6 TVs on this one. And each pixel of your TV at home comprises of several transistors and light emitting layers, in fact. And the density of transistors is about 10,000 transistors per square centimeter. So such a plate will have 1 billion transistors. The typical dimensions are 2 micrometer, in fact. Now, if we would divide our big screen or our big glass plate with a smaller circuit, and we make TFT chips, we could have 1 million TFT chips on these plates and like 3,000 per second. In terms of cost, you can see here, for example, you can buy this TV for 200 euro. And in this TV, there is a TFT array, there is light emitting layers, there is a backlight, there is LCD layers, etc. So if you subtract this price, you can think about an engineering estimate, but I would like to put a big disclaimer here, because it depends on many things, and specifically on mass production as well. But of $200 to $300 per square meter, which is about $1 if you make a very small RFID or TFT chip. Again, big disclaimer, but it shows the potential. Another option is not the flat panel display industry, but is Pragmatic. Interestingly, Pragmatic took another route and they focused on wafer-based technology and introduced some kind of Moore's law on flex, because today they don't have 2 micrometer devices, but they are already at 0.8 micrometer devices. So we've been making circuits in the technology of Pragmatic with 0.8 micrometer devices, and we will very soon have the first publications with that. This is their fully automated FlexLogic fab, and I'm sure that in this the webinar in a few weeks from Pragmatic, you will learn much more about this. Rapid design cycles, also potential low cost, and billions of these flexible chips per year. Okay, the next part in this presentation is about thin film transistor technology. We spoke about applications, we spoke about where can you make it, but now, how does it look like? Here you can see at the left a nice cross section of a full display stack, all flex. So we start with the flexible substrates with some barrier layers. Then this part is the transistor. So you have a gate, you have a source and a drain, and you have your active region. In this case, it could have been IGZO, indium gallium zinc oxide. Then you have an interface to the light emitting layer, in this case an OLED. You put some barrier and polarizers, etc., and you have your display. This part is called front plane, this part is called the back plane, and this is your substrate. As I said, the substrate can be glass or polymer. It can be made on wafer, pragmatic option, or on flat panel, not the display field. And then you have different technologies, amorphous silicon, IGZO, or low temperature polycrystalline silicon. And on top of these transistors, you can put emitters, you can put absorbers to make imagers, or you can put the transducers that I presented to create ultrasound activity. Of course, for circuits, you can remove, in fact, the front plane, and you end up with only the back plane. Now, you can make integrated circuits similar as a silicon CMOS flow directly on polymer in one of those technologies, and you can make RFID chips, ADCs, memory chips, drivers, etc. Okay, we spoke about amorphous silicon, IGZO, LTPS. So, for the ones who don't know this, what is the differences between them? Okay, so in this table, you can see crystalline silicon, that's the most common technology. It has a very good charge carrier mobility and stability, etc., but it has a very high process temperature, and that's why it's not directly on flex. The IGZO, or amorphous metal oxide, has a mobility or a performance which is 100 times less, but it has a very good process temperature enabling these polyimides or other foils. The main drawback of amorphous metal oxide is the n-type only semiconductor. For the ones interested, these have extremely low leakage currents. 10 to the minus 22 amps per micrometer, for example. It's very hard to measure the leakage current effect. The last technology I want to like to discuss is this LTPS, low temperature polysilicon. This has a better mobility or an improved mobility compared to metal oxide. It has CMOS. It is in fact flex compatible, so polyimide compatible, but it's a bit more complex to make. And that's why it's a bit higher cost, in fact, compared to a standard amorphous metal oxide transistor technology. What are now design challenges? So as a designer, you will get these transistors, and if you measure them, you will see, like, for a 2 micrometer channel length, this plots 216 transistors. First things you see, the mobility is low, so you don't have a very high ion. So you have a low intrinsic gain, you have unipolar transistors, so n-type only, and your applications require low power. In addition, the system specifications are very challenging, because if you want to adhere to any of these standards, you need to comply to these standards, and they're all set for silicon. In addition, the validated models, the design flow, and it's not really existing or it's growing now, and you have a limited amount of metal layers. Gate source drain, some foundries in fact offer a few more metal layers to do better routing optimization. Let's now build an inverter, the most basic digital block. In fact, all of you would say you CMOS, P-type, N-type, done. Well, in fact, if you use a IGZO, you only have N-types. So what do you do? The most obvious solution then is to connect 2 N-types. You connect this one, the gate, to the drain, and you have a diode load inverter. If you then would measure this device, you see this characteristics. And it's not really a robust solution. That's why we have discovered, or we have been working on, a very nice advantage of this technology. you can put an individual backgate to this each of the transistors, and you can individually power them. And because of this, you can actually shift this curve, and you can have a curve which already looks very nice, and it looks more close to a real inverter. It has only two TFTs, but it needs an additional power rail, namely minus VDD. And another common strategy in these technologies would be to add one stage. So you have the diode load, and you add a source follower slash level shifter stage. This also has a very nice transfer curve, but you have four transistors per inverter and three power rails. What about process design kits? Well, process design kits, they are available for CMOS, for the CMOS design flows. You can design an RTL coding, your VHDL, you can do your simulations, you can make your synthesis, then your gate level simulation, get a netlist, you do the place and route, and then DRC, design rule check, layout versus schematic, some parasitics, post layout, etc. That's a complete design flow. How far are we with TFTs? Well, in fact, crystalline silicon, this design flow is fully available, as we all know. But for amorphous metal oxide, which is pragmatic, in fact, they are offering in their foundry service a first generation of a PDK. For the low temperature polysilicon of the display field, we also collaborate with these foundries, and we have actually a PDK set up at IMEC to design and allowing the design in these foundry technologies. Okay. Let's now dive into a bit more technical and to show you a bit of demonstrators. So, the first one is the IGZO-based NFC tag. So that's an unipolar N-type NFC tag. In fact, you have a phone, you have an antenna, and it emits a certain field at 13.56 MHz. This needs to be detected by your antenna and your capacitance. You have a power unit, then you have to generate your clocks, you read out your memory, you format your data, and you modulate your data on the antenna again to backscatter it to the NFC phone. Which are now the main challenges? Well, first of all, for N-type only transistors with a mobility that is a factor 100 lower than silicon, 13.56 MHz is actually pretty fast. But that's a big challenge. In addition, this memory is also a challenge. Why? Because it's already a big chip. And N-type only logic suffers from static power consumption, and the more gates you add, the more power you consume. And you actually have very limited power. How did we do it? Well, here comes the Moore's law on flex. In fact, we have been building a ring oscillator, and you see on this axis the stage delay of the ring oscillator versus the supply. The NFC spec, which is 7 point something nanoseconds, was the one to reach for clock division. And we did some design tech co-optimization indeed. And downscaling channel length leads to faster stage delays, faster ring oscillators, and we are beyond the specs. But that was not sufficient because we wanted to be beyond the specs on the full supply rail, and that's why we implemented the fast implementations of this logic gate. Fast is just a change or a modification of the channel lengths and the channel widths of these devices. In the end, we succeeded and we reached an unprecedented 2.4 nanosecond gate delay, which was published at IVCC and Nature Electronics. We have made also a very simple clock divider by a toggle flip-flop. And here you see the 13.56 MHz. As predicted, at channel length 2, you can actually reach your 13.56 MHz and the logic operates there. This video shows actually the example of a working flex NFC tag. So you see there is no silicon involved. This is your chip. When you put your phone on it, it will transfer its code and be tapped into the phone. So this was the world first demonstration of this flex NFC tag. some improvements what we have been making nowadays was, for example, to move to screen-printed antennas. Together with one of the partners which we'll present later, namely Quad Industries, they have been nicely plotting or printing the reader antenna and the chip antenna. And this combination also made a very nice entrance control system. Okay. NFC tags is one item, but there is many more touchscreens in the world. And that's why the Internet of Things would be very interesting. So here you see there is touchscreens in your car, on your fridge, on your phones. So we have been developing together with this consortium C-touch tags or capacitive touchscreen tags, which can directly interface a touchscreen. What you see is this was our tag. It was connected to one of these cells only, so a small PV cell, an energy harvesting, which takes the light from the phone, energizes our tag, and transmits its code again to the phone. And this was recently published also in Nature Electronics. This slide actually shows the performance bounds for thin film electronics. You can see at the left axis, the vertical axis, the clock speed versus the mobility for different, and we have categorized the different TFT technologies: metal oxide, polysilicon, and crystalline silicon. The lines, the colored lines, are actually different channel lengths in that technology. So our NFC chip actually fits here. Now, if you would like to make a UHF chip, what you need to do with IZ0, for example, metal oxides, you would need either to go to extremely low channel lengths, well, or you need to be able to go, or you need to find a way to get higher mobility, which is moving to, for example, polysilicon. What we learn from this is, in fact, that Bluetooth and Wi-Fi and all these high-end ultra gigahertz communication medium is today not really available for flex. There is a lot of research to be done before we can even reach that. But below these frequencies, you can do a lot of different communications. Now you say, but IGZO, but what about the P-types? Well, P-types is the holy grail for this field, in fact. One option is to take the P-type from LTPS, but the other option is the P-type oxides, which, if you look at today's publication, or they have hysteresis, or they suffer from leakage currents. One of the reasons to move to CMOS would be to reduce the static power consumption. Now, if you have leakage currents, your IOF actually at 0 volt will be your leakage current, and you can see that the static power will actually be also still too large for your applications. Let's now change gear and move a bit to wearables. So there is a couple of options what you can do. One is you take a standard wearable and you focus on the electrons. So what Professor Sekitani has been doing was putting locally a TFT differential amplifier to improve the signal-to-noise ratio, to reduce motion artifacts and to get a better signal quality. And he actually succeeded very nicely. So local amplification at the electrode. The other side would be wireless readout. So you make a fully ECG system, which is capturing your data and transmitting it wirelessly to a phone. That's what we have been doing together with TU Eindhoven very recently as well. We have been building a fully TFT-based ECG system. How did we do it? Well, the analog designers amongst you, you can build a conventional ADC. You would have an analog frontend, you amplify your signal, you have some ADC, and you get your serial output. Now, the issue is that this component, the DAC, the digital to analog converter, that needs a stable reference voltage generator. And we don't have bipolar junctions, we don't have diodes. So in fact, this is a very challenging component. That's why We have been looking into a time-based ADC. So you have your analog frontend, that's the same, but then you generate a PWM waveform, you do some logic and counter, and you get your time-based ADC. Why did we select that? Well, the reference and facts, we have known from the previous work that our time reference can be stable. It can come from the phone, we generate it on the phone, and it can be 13.56 MHz. And that's what was the basis of this architecture. Then we have built a reset integrator and then some counters. And here you can see that it was in vivo tested, so our PhD students in fact have been wearing this device or his own patch, and it was working very nicely. And it shows in fact all the different waves of this ECG that you need to detect. Besides this, we also have been looking into security, because security, imagine we all will wear wearable patches, then security is another big theme, because you don't want to have everybody reading out your data. So you want to have confidential data transfer. What do you need for that? In fact, you need to integrate crypto cores on flexible chips. And that's one of the challenges, because a standard crypto core consumes the similar amount of transistors compared to your full NFC chip, and or even more. And that's actually the main challenge, because remember, the static power consumption is actually going to block you in this application and the area of your circuit as well. And another one is, of course, if you make a secure chip, you need to have key bits which cannot be read out. And the main security challenge here is that these chips are unpackaged. You saw our NFC tag, you can look into it, and we don't have non-volatile memory available. So how did we solve it? Well, at first we have proposed to use a very lightweight algorithm. This lightweight algorithm, for example, is Katantan 32. It comprised 4,044 N-type transistors, and it was powered at 10 volts. Now, this was running at 10 kilohertz, and you can see that we used an 80-bit key for this algorithm. So these lightweight algorithms are actually small and efficient hardware block ciphers. Now, this part has been proven and working now, and we have published that at this conference, the CHESS conference, in fact. But next to this, we also looked into how to generate this key with this unpackaged and an existence of non-volatile memory. Well, in fact, you can see one of our devices. We have been building some kind of an inverter where the input was in fact a bias voltage. And depending whether we shine light or we programmed it by laser, in fact, you can have no current or a high current. And in fact, that's the difference what you see here. Now, this one is a high current, which means that it will pull your current down, so your key bit is zero. This one is no current or a leakage current, in fact, and your key bit will remain one. And that's how we were able to program these key bits for being read out. So this brings me to the summary of this presentation. So in fact, flexible electronics is already available today. You can go to the shop and you can buy, for example, the Samsung Galaxy Fold, so your foldable phone. There is other companies that also are selling these foldable, flexible phones. In addition, it doesn't stop at the small size device, it also moves to the bigger devices like a rollable TV demonstration of LG, where you have your big holder. And if you want, you can roll out your TV to watch TV, and then you can remove it again. So yes, flexible electronics, you can buy it. That's also why this webinar series are at the right moment. Because the second reason is, there are already non-display application products that have been demonstrated by several companies. I just list here two. So you have Pragmatic, who have made their flexible TFT tags, Exo-based, and you have AUO, Taiwanese display manufacturer, who have also been showing a flexible TFT-based NFC tag. So the NFC RFID tag today is already or could become available on the market as a first non-display applications. Of course, next to the X-ray, next to these kind of images. But then, as another conclusion, what we have shown on this slide, and I showed you only a couple of them, I gave you a glimpse of them, some key blocks have been demonstrated, like the wireless tags, like a microprocessor. We can do signage control. In terms of memory, there were SRAM, there was ROM, there is programmable ROM, in fact, but laser programmable ROM, in fact. And then there's ADCs. I didn't talk too much about that, but we can make 6 to 8 bit ADCs on flex, in fact. So key IP blocks have been demonstrated. And PDKs, as I told you, process design kits, or the kits that help you to design, in fact, they are created also for TFT electronics. Pragmatic is offering them in their foundry service, and we have been developing it for the display foundries. And then, in fact, today, there is a design and foundry service available for these metal oxides and for the LTPS, which can be both unipolar. You can order the P-type only, or you can use the CMOS. It brings me to the acknowledgement. So I would like to thank all my co-workers from IMEC, the whole center, and Kai Leuven for their contributions and for their help. I would also like to thank Theo Eindhoven for the help in the wearable healthcare patch and their contributions. And I would like to thank the ERC project as well for their financial support to do actually this kind of nice research. In addition, I would like to thank you for your attendance to this conference and to this webinar series, and I would welcome all questions. And before I end, I would like to make a promotion already for the next webinar in 2 weeks, which will be by Dr. Vincent Barnier from Pragmatic, and he will focus, in fact, on the possibilities of Pragmatic technologies. Thank you.